Hachette Audio presents America in the World, A History of U.S. Diplomacy and Foreign Policy by Robert B. Zoellick, read by Brian Troxell.
Introduction. America's First Diplomat. Inventing American Diplomacy. On the evening of February 6, 1778, Ben Franklin arrived at the Parisian offices of the French foreign minister, Le Comte de Vergennes, to sign America's first two treaties, a military alliance and a trade accord. Recognition of the new United States, a novel republic, by the venerable and powerful monarchy of France was as momentous as the promise of arms and commerce. As the delegations gathered, Silas Deane, one of Franklin's fellow commissioners, expressed curiosity about Franklin's suit, a worn blue coat of Manchester velvet. When asked about his attire for this memorable occasion, Franklin replied that his selection was to give it a little revenge. 4 years before, in 1774, Franklin had been humiliated by the British Crown's Solicitor General, Alexander Wedderburn, at the hearing of the Privy Council in Westminster. The censure had been in a room known as the cockpit, describing its function as a place of entertainment during the reign of Henry VIII. For an hour, Franklin had stood motionless before the 36 sitting members of the council, while Wedderburn scornfully attacked the 68-year-old Philadelphian for his release of letters that had embarrassed the governor and lieutenant governor of Massachusetts. The ostensible reason for the assembly was to hear the petition of the Bay Colony to remove the Crown's executives, but Wedderburn instead chastised Franklin. The Privy Council enjoyed the show. The king's advisors laughed, clapped, and jeered. Franklin remained silent and without expression. The British governing class of 1774 was a select club. The men present knew one another. To lose face was to be stripped of respect and power. The Whig political philosopher and parliamentarian Edmund Burke, who witnessed Wedderburn's diatribe, described the scolding as beyond all bounds and measure. Lord Shelburne, who in 1783 would be fated to discharge the unpleasant task of approving the Treaty of American Independence, wrote former Prime Minister William Pitt that the Solicitor General's performance had been scurrilous invective. Franklin said it was like bull baiting. Personal experiences influenced diplomats, and this one was a turning point for Franklin. Wedderburn's ridicule had turned a loyal friend of Britain into a determined enemy. Thus, 4 years after Wedderburn's verbal execution, on that February night of 1778, Franklin acknowledged to Deane that the suit he had chosen for the treaty ceremony with France was the same one that he had worn in the cockpit. Diplomacy includes settling scores. Diplomacy involves deceit as well. Edward Bancroft, Franklin's private secretary, was a British spy. Right after the signing of the treaties in 1778, Bancroft rushed to make copies and deliver them to London within 42 hours. Bancroft even managed to get word to a London partner in advance of the signing so that they could short stocks and profit handsomely from the news of the French-American alliance. Diplomacy moves markets and attracts scoundrels. Franklin is America's first diplomat. His representation actually began in 1757, when the Pennsylvania Assembly sent the famous printer, publicist, inventor, scientist, community organizer and politician to represent its interests in London. Over the course of 17 years, the colonies of Georgia, Massachusetts, and New Jersey also engaged Franklin as an envoy. Franklin loved England. As tensions increased between the colonists and London, the Philadelphian offered both visionary plans and practical suggestions to preserve and extend the empire of loyal Englishmen. Franklin had urged Britain to retain control of Canada at the end of the Seven Years' War in 1763, one of many Franklin efforts to think of America in continental terms. Later, he proposed that the American colonies receive representation in Parliament. Abandoning the idea of parliamentary supremacy over the colonies, Franklin then proposed a union of separate states, subject to the sovereignty of the crown, much like the later British dominions. Franklin's diplomacy also extended to specific solutions. As late as December 1774, even after Franklin's battering in the cockpit, he replied to informal emissaries from the king's ministers with 17 points of hints to resolve the crisis between London and the First American Continental Congress. But the two sides turned instead to a contest of arms, will, and international diplomacy. When Franklin arrived in France in December 1776 to represent the new United States, he faced a challenge even greater than his experience in London. Paris had not recognized Franklin's country, nor had any other capital. The United States was, in reality, a loose confederation of former colonies. About a decade before, in league with their mother country, the British colonies had warred with France. Franklin's new government, an experimental republic, was untested, starting a war, creating an army and a tiny navy, and trying to raise revenue, all while loudly voicing diverse views. Franklin's mission challenged the most powerful empire in the world. He sought money, weapons, and supplies, as well as political recognition. Later, he urged the direct commitment of French troops and the assistance of France's fleets. And while wooing the French king, Franklin and his compatriots needed to achieve credibility across Europe in order to seek Dutch loans and perhaps a Spanish alliance as well. Franklin combined a new type of public diplomacy with the old. While the United States was unknown, Franklin was famous. He personalized his representation of America in ways that appealed to French opinion, even to its sense of style. The 1766 portrait of Franklin in London by David Martin is that of a gentleman scholar, wearing reading glasses and studying a book, and watched over by Isaac Newton. In France, artists painted Franklin as the frontier philosophe in his famous Martin fur cap from Canada, wearing plain brown suits with no wig, and adored by playful Parisian ladies. Franklin's likeness graced medals, prints, snuff boxes, rings, and even a chamber pot that Louis XVI gave to an enthusiastic Franklin fan. To intrigue the intellectual society of Paris, Franklin highlighted the exceptional nature of America's cause. He arranged for the publication of the Articles of Confederation, state constitutions, and other Republican documents. The old publisher also planted anonymous pieces, especially parodies, to feed rumors, amuse, and mock. Franklin's diplomacy appealed to France's sense of self, its respect for the nobility of ideas, culture, and civilization, but also Gallic worldliness, wit, and pride as the historic power of Europe. At the same time, Franklin was alert to diplomatic verities. For more than four centuries, France and England had been enemies. France yearned to avenge its defeat by Britain in the Seven Years' War of 1756 to 63, in which Paris lost its American colonies. Now was the moment for George III to lose his. The wealthier plantation islands of the Caribbean might also fall to Paris. A Franco-American victory could restore balance among European empires. France could assert its leadership in Europe by luring Spain and the Netherlands to join the cause against Britain. France might also rely upon future prospects, whether of commerce or power. The vast territory of the new United States was the size of present-day Britain, France, and Germany combined, and the 13 states, with less than 3 million people, had room to grow. Franklin's diplomacy operated through private channels as well as official ones. Indeed, he had to proceed indirectly before Louis XVI's recognition of the United States in 1778. Franklin enlisted French officers, materials, and private contributions. He was courting a country while enabling the French government to appear not to take sides.
Franklin's friend. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.